Dear Blizzard, hi, it's me, Austin. Can I level with you for a second? I've been trying not to swear too much. It makes Matt Pat cry, and bleeps just aren't satisfying for me. It's like holding in a sneeze. There's no rush of endorphins. There's no satisfying cascade of consonants and syllables cutting through the air and offending sensitive ears. Just one anticlimactic tone stealing my thunder. It hurts my heart. So I've been trying to do it less, but honestly, Blizzard, what the f*** am I supposed to do with you? You made a character like Tracer. Why? What's the matter with you? You know how many people I have on my jock day in, day out, demanding that I do an episode on her? Do you think about how your actions affect anyone other than yourself, Blizzard? I'm trying coffee instead of alcohol this week because it's important to switch up your science-enhancing drugs from time to time. Unique problems call for unique solutions. And Tracer? Tracer isn't the kind of thing you can tackle with depressants. No, this problem, this final problem, calls for stimulants. Sweet caffeine, what would I do without you? I spend most of my time trying to debunk video game science because, as Carrie so lovingly pointed out, I love ruining things that you love. I'm just, like, secretly a terrible person. I am Austin the Destroyer! But this week, I'm gonna do something a little bit different. Instead of no goddamn sensing everywhere today, I'm gonna try my absolute best to explain exactly how Tracer and her powers work. Because the basic truth of the matter is that sometimes science confounds logic as we've come to understand it. In order to understand how Tracer works, first we're gonna have to look at her lore. Tracer, aka Lena Oxton, was the youngest person ever recruited for Overwatch's flight program, and was the first person to pilot a prototype teleporting fighter known as the Slipstream. But, of course, at the last minute, things messed up. Because of course they did, and Tracer disappeared along with the Slipstream. Everyone thought she was dead, and then kablam! Months later, she reappeared out of nowhere. This is really, really easy to explain. When we think of teleportation, we tend to imagine some sort of quantum entanglement, quantum state copying, more on that later, but this accidental time travel to the future thing is actually straightforward. I'm not gonna get into too many details since we don't have time and everything else is more complicated, and I've talked a hell of a lot about Einstein already, but the gist is this. Time traveling to the future is super easy to do. In fact, here's a guaranteed way to build a time machine to the future in your very own home. Don't do anything at all. Being a little bit cheeky here, but it's true. Time is always moving forward, even when you're not doing anything. Even while watching this video, you're time traveling to the future. It's the long lost, less epic original ending for Back to the Future. Marty just holes up in a hut outside of town and becomes the regional alcoholic hermit. You'll get back to the future, eventually. But no, I know, this isn't typically what we're talking about when we mean time travel, and this obviously isn't what happened to Tracer in that Slipstream thingy. She wasn't just sitting around for 3 months, a few feet away from where they were expecting her to be, waiting for someone to come pick her up. She completely vanished and then reappeared months later. How the heck is this possible? Simple. Moving really, really fast. When we mentioned space-time so far on this show, we've talked a hell of a lot about the space aspect, but not a lot about the time one. But they're both linked together. Mass, like a planet, doesn't just bend the curvature of space, it also bends time. Gravity affects the passage of time, but not just gravity. Relative velocity, or relative speed, does too. For example, if you're just sitting in a chair next to your friend watching this video, 1 second of time for the both of you is exactly the same. However, if you get up and go to the fridge to get a Mountain Dew, and it takes you 1 second to get to the fridge, taking into account that the average walking speed is 1.4 meters per second, and the fridge is really close, 1.000000000000000000000000000010904 seconds passes for your friend. Although given the sugar and caffeine content of Mountain Dew, I'm not sure that the 100 quadrillionth of a second that you save is gonna do much to extend your life. Knowing this, it becomes pretty obvious exactly how Tracer disappeared for literal months because of one tiny malfunction, plus it explains almost exactly how the slipstream craft she was piloting works. It's not a teleporter that actually dismantles the atoms and rearranges them elsewhere. Rather, it's a ship capable of accelerating to high fractions of the speed of light. Moving this quickly, you could disappear on one end of the Earth and reappear elsewhere in the blink of an eye. Faster, actually. And when going these speeds, small mistakes can have exponentially terrible consequences. For instance, Tracer's hypothetical slipstream ship could travel from California to New York City in a little over a tenth of a second of our stationary or normal time if she moved at 99.999999999256% of the speed of light for only 5/100 millionths of a second of Tracer's time. We'll just casually ignore how it would take 1.7 yottagrams of energy, or approximately 1/5 of the energy the sun hits the Earth with every year, to accelerate to this speed. In any case, this same ship, if it were to have some sort of calculation error and, say, fire for 30 seconds instead of 5/100 millionths of a second, 30 seconds of Tracer's time would solidly land her over 3 months in the future. Of course, she'd also be moving quickly enough to reach the sun and return to the Earth over 15,000 times, but who's counting? This is the danger of traveling near light speeds. Tiny mistakes and computer glitches can cause irreversible problems, and these kind of casual computer errors happen all the time. I mean, in 1998, NASA, some of the smartest freaking people on our planet, incinerated the Mars Climate Orbiter by accidentally sending instructions in pounds instead of newtons. And as a result, the orbiter dipped too far into the atmosphere of Mars and was burned up by entry friction. It's important to go over this accident of Tracer's, even though it's just backstory for the main Overwatch page, because it gives you a taste of how time relates to space. And trust me, for this next part, it's gonna take all of your training to understand, because traveling to the future doesn't hold a candle to the mind-bending, everyday superpowers Tracer uses in every single Overwatch game. The reason I've been so loath to do an episode on Tracer is because, well, her powers are frankly absurd. They defy logic, and trying to figure them out gave me a splitting headache. But I'm channeling my inner Tyson, Neil deGrasse, not Mike, and together we can crack this! Tracer has two key powers which she controls through her chronofabulous oscillator, or whatever the hell the thing on her chest is called. One is straightforward. She zips forward about 7.5 meters in a blink of an eye. Super! But it's recall that bends the mind. Recall is Tracer's signature power that lets her zip back through time in the middle of a fight. How the heck is this possible? You see, Tracer's recall power is weird. Super weird. It's not just time travel like in Back to the Future, where she goes back and might accidentally run into her past self. No, it's so much weirder. Over the course of 1 second, Tracer moves back to the exact place and physical condition she was in 3 seconds from when she first activated her powers. That is, by the time she arrives wherever she was, she has effectively traveled back in time 4 seconds. But it gets weirder. You see, time around her doesn't stop. Everything she did in those 3 seconds actually happened. They don't get reversed along with her. Even more mind-bogglingly, Tracer herself retains all knowledge of the events that transpired. Classically, if we're talking Einstein, you travel to the future faster as you approach the speed of light. If, however, it were possible to exceed the speed of light, you'd actually be able to travel into the past. Of course, this is impossible. In order to understand how Tracer does this, we're gonna have to leave Einstein at the door. Actually, we're gonna have to partner with one of his greatest enemies, Kurt Gödel. You see, Einstein liked things to be pretty cut and dry, and he was famously a skeptic of quantum mechanics. Thankfully, in his mind, special and general relativity were as clear-cut as things could get. No wacky stuff like wave-particle duality here, and then, on his 70th birthday, his buddy Kurt Gödel presented to Einstein a solution to his formulas that was messy and, even more irritatingly, would allow traveling to the past without exceeding the speed of light. Closed time-like curves. Kurt Gödel was kind of a weirdo. He saw conspiracy theories and loopholes everywhere he went. He was like Neo, but instead of seeing the code of the Matrix, he saw exploits in every system. Other than ruining the birthdays of mathematical geniuses, Gödel claimed he found a loophole in the American Constitution that would secretly allow for it to become a dictatorship without anybody realizing it. No further comment from me on that. If video games existed in 1948, he would have been an amazing speedrunner, traveling faster than the speed of light for any object that has mass, and presumably also massless objects, is impossible. The energy requirements to reach the speed of light is infinite for reasons we won't get into today. Don't argue, just trust me. I'm a scientist. So even though if you could theoretically go faster than the speed of light to travel into the past, this isn't possible, but Gödel discovered a way to do this that avoided having to travel faster than the speed of light at all. With closed time-like curves, Gödel realized that you can actually take advantage of the fluid nature of space-time itself to travel back in time without having to reach ludicrous speeds. This works because it's not just speed that deforms time, but also gravity. For instance, if you were, say, near a strong gravity source like, a black hole, for instance, and that gravity source were spinning at a significant speed, the fabric of space-time around it would be so distorted that it could actually swirl back on itself, creating what is essentially a wormhole in space-time that loops back in time, i.e. a closed, time-like curve. But unfortunately, none of this explains how Tracer herself travels back in time 3 seconds into the past without space itself around her also reversing into the past. After all, time and space are inextricably linked. If you go back in time, you're not just like rewinding yourself, you're traveling to a previous point in space-time, where the stuff that happened in what was once the present hasn't happened yet. I'm not sure coffee was the right substance for this episode, but here I am, sunk into my life choices. You see, the big problem I have with Tracer traveling back into the past is that, well, it violates causality, and it would mean that there should, in theory, be two Tracers capable of interacting with one another. I also thought that maybe it was possible that what was actually happening was the past Tracer was traveling into the future. But then it creates a whole series of problems, like how the hell does she know to do that, and how does she have memories of what happened in the future? I mean, this isn't just a problem postulated by in-game mechanics. If you watch the Overwatch trailer Alive, where Tracer is fighting Black Widow, you see that this is exactly how Tracer's power works in the narrative canon as well. It's not just a limitation of the gameplay. But what if Tracer isn't technically traveling into the past, but rather information is? You see, if you watch my Portal episode, you already know that things like wormholes and closed time-like curves require exponentially increasing amounts of energy depending upon how long they exist and how large they are. However, information, if sent quickly enough, requires only very small openings for very short periods of time to travel. And it's here where quantum mechanics, Kurt Gödel, and Einstein's migraine finally harmonized to explain exactly how Tracer's powers work. And boy oh boy, it's a doozy. The instant Tracer activates her recall power, you see a quick distortion of space around her, lensing of light. This, presumably, is the consequence of the creation of a tiny black hole that exists just long enough to spin really fast and connect to the past before it evaporates into nothingness due to Hawking radiation, although I hesitate to mention Hawking because he, like Einstein, absolutely loathes closed time-like curves. But I'm getting off track. During this brief instant, several things happen almost simultaneously. One, Tracer of the Present's particles become entangled with Tracer of the Past. Particle for particle, Tracer of the Past and Tracer of the Present are bound in what's called a Bell state. Number two, Tracer of the Present's molecules, and therefore her biology, run in reverse until her quantum state matches the quantum state of the past perfectly. As a result, she ends up at the same location and physical state she was 3 seconds from when she enacted the recall. Effectively, this is teleportation, but instead of teleporting from place to place, past Tracer is teleporting to the present by copying her quantum state onto Tracer of the Present through the closed time-like curve. This is actually more or less how quantum teleportation actually works. The Niels Bohr Institute was even able to do this with 100% reliability. Of course, this means that somehow Tracer's brain and nervous system is omitted from this quantum teleportation, but somehow also moves back in the past and wait a minute. Oh, crap. The no cloning theorem! Crap! Motherfucker! cloning theorem of quantum mechanics is the bane of my existence and the killer of Pokemon states that while quantum information can be transferred from one particle to another, exact copies cannot exist. Say you have atom of tracer A, and there's atom of tracer B. You can make it so atom of tracer B perfectly matches atom of tracer A, but as a result, atom of tracer A ends up being, I don't know, atom of tracer C instead. It totally messes up everything. Which means even though we can ignore matter requirements since there are two tracers, if tracer of the present copies the quantum state of tracer of the past, she would irreversibly change tracer of the past's quantum state. Best case scenario, she ends up with some sort of mega cancer or has all of her memories erased. But what's just as likely is that her atoms blast off as she explodes because the particles are no longer working in harmony like they're supposed to. This also means the past tracer is irreversibly changed, which means that present tracer is irreversibly changed, and when she goes to use recall, she'll be making a crappy copy of a copy, which means that past tracer's quantum state will be messed up again, which means that present tracer's quantum state is messed up again, which means that when she uses recall, she'll be making an even crappier copy of a crappy copy, and I just can't, Blizzard! I tried, but I can't do this! I can't! You made a freaking character that plays jump rope with the rules of quantum mechanics and the space-time continuum and just left me out to dry. What the hell is wrong with you? Best case scenario for Tracer is, hey, guess what? She's dead. Why is this the best case scenario? Because the worst case scenario is that she gets stuck in an infinite time loop where she gets progressively less recognizable as human every 3 seconds until she's just a blob of goo on the floor. Is that what you want, Blizzard? Do you want ants? Because that is how we get ants! I'm sorry. No matter how hard I try, I just can't justify or explain Tracer. She defies logic. She defies reason. She defies everything we know about science. I'm sorry to say it, but from the bottom of my heart, Blizzard, I do mean it. Tracer makes no goddamn sense. Sincerely, Austin. Thank you everyone for watching my video on Tracer! I really did try to make her make sense, but she doesn't at all. But that's okay, not everything has to make sense. Also, I'm tired of doing so much space-timey-wimey stuff, and I'm sure you are tired of me doing the same, so next time I have something a little special for you. So, if you're interested, be sure to subscribe. It's gonna be awesome.